You know, today I want to talk a little bit about kind of walking in the fullness of who God says we are. You know, God says you're an incredible, incredible masterpiece that he has created anew to do something great with your life. But I think a lot of times we come and we hear a message, but we walk out of here and we don't just always walk in the fullness of God's promise. And a few weeks ago, God began to put a location that's found in the Bible on my heart, and I began to kind of study and kind of work through that location. Many of you have probably heard about it numerous times in the Bible. It's referred to as the Promised Land. It's the land of Canaan. And as I began to kind of study Canaan, I thought, man, you know, the Bible says it's a land with provision that flows with milk and honey. It's how it describes it. And God promised it to the nation of Israel, and they had to enter that land and begin to work through the process of really capturing all that God had in that land for them. And Joshua was the leader that led the people into the promised land, into the land flowing with milk and honey, the land of Canaan. But something interesting about that land to me is this. It is a land that God described as flowing with milk and honey, but it didn't come to them without battles. They had to battle in the land of Canaan. Anybody ever face a few battles in life? Come on. Yeah, and see, the Bible teaches us that the things of the Old Testament through the nation of Israel and through what God did through this physical group of people, these things can teach us a lot about our life spiritually today. And so we can look back at their physical journey and we can learn something about our spiritual journey and our eternal life with God. And so I love to reflect back into the Old Testament a lot of times and see what God did in people's life so we can learn what he is doing in our life. And so, you know, the Bible tells us in Romans and also in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 that those things are there to teach us today. Now, I think a lot of people just kind of look at those as historical events, but I find them as great encouragement and great strength to live my life daily. And I want you to find that too, because God has called us to live a victorious life. A life full of incredible victory. And even in the day of the Israelites' journey, there were many people that didn't receive that. There were many people that didn't believe that. And the Bible says a whole generation of people wandered around aimlessly for 40 years in a desert simply because they didn't trust the promises of God. And then God allowed a man named Joshua to take a nation of people into the fullness of God's promise. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to wander around for 40 years and not experience the provision of God. I want to have the audacity and the belief in my heart to trust what God has said and step into it. And the greatest encouragement I can find here in my life is to look you in the eye, to look you in the spirit of your heart and say, hey, would you come with me as we cross over into the fullness of God's promise? And so many people just kind of like, well, I'm not really sure. Listen, I don't want to leave you in the desert. But we're crossing over. And the first thing that Joshua tells the leaders to tell the people is get yourself ready. Get ready, because in 3 days, we're crossing over. And listen, basically what Jesus said on the cross 2,000 years ago is get ready. We're crossing over. And so many people don't receive that. But today I hope to encourage you. I hope to motivate you to live what I call in the sweet spot of God's success. The sweet spot of God's success. The fullness of God's promise. And So I got this little cute sweet spot here today to remind you of what it means to live in the sweet spot of God's success. And so I'm going to simply lay it here. You need to pray that I don't slip on this today. But the truth of the matter is, if we're going to live in the sweet spot of God's success and the fullness of what God says about our life, what our Creator says about our life, you know, we got to trust Him with our heart, and we've got to step in to that spot and then allow Him to tell us, as our Creator, what He has created us to be and to do and how He's created us to live. The word for that is called surrender. Surrender. And so many of us don't want to surrender our own wants, our own needs, our own desires, because, you know, we're plagued by this thing called sin, and a lot of times it blinds us to God has a better life for us. God has a life that He has created for us to live. And I want to invite you into that today, how to live in the fullness of God's promise. First and foremost, you know, you need to trust what God has done. The Bible says He has forgiven humanity of their sin. He died on a cross. Jesus stretched out His arms to forgive us of our sin, of our misses, of missing the mark of God's glorious standard. God's glorious standard for humanity is they would be in a right relationship with Him. He would provide for humans. He would cause all the provision they would ever need, all the protection they would ever need, and they would walk with Him in the fullness of who He says they are. But the Bible says the wheels came off in Genesis, and the people stepped out of God's plan. And all of us have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard. But I'm going to invite you back into God's glorious standard today. And we do that through what Christ offered to us on a cross, His death, burial, and resurrection. But many of you have trusted Christ for the forgiveness of your sin. But each and every day, man, you don't walk in the fullness of God's promise. Did you know that God says, Jesus says in John 10:10, I came to give life and give it to the full. He didn't say, I just came to give life. He says, I came to give it and give it to the full. So how do we walk in the fullness of God's promises as believers in Jesus Christ? Remember, Canaan is a great land of promise, but it's also a land that the people had to fight many, many battles in order to experience the fullness of God's promise. And what God desires more for you and more for me is this. He desires us to rest. Everybody say rest. Really, the land of Canaan is a place of great rest. He desires for our souls to rest, to not be anxious about anything. He desires for us not to worry. He desires for us, you know, to trust Him and walk with Him. And so God wants us to rest in the fullness of who He says He is and in the fullness of who He says we are. But a lot of times we don't rest because we're listening to what everybody else says we are, and we don't take the time to know who God says we are. And so if you really want to rest, we want rest for our soul. We want to begin to clear away the anxiety. We want rest for our soul. We've got to know, if we want to live in the sweet spot, we've got to know what God has said. We have to know what God has said. We have to know what God has said. And some of us are looking for God to say something else when He has said everything He needs to say for us to rest in the fullness of who He says we are. We have to know what God has said. Listen to what God tells the great leader Joshua about inspiring the people to live in the sweet spot of God's success. Joshua chapter 1. And if you go home and read the book of Joshua, it's about 24 It's about 24 chapters, but it's incredible because Joshua continually walked in the fullness of who God said he was. And Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 and 9 say this. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses, Joshua, your leader, gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. And then you will be successful. You will live in the sweet spot of God's success. You will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually, not just 3 minutes a day, but continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper. Everybody say prosper. God desires for you and I to prosper. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And God doesn't say, be careful to obey everything that I have commanded. Don't deviate from it. You know, meditate on it day and night. He doesn't say all of that. So we'll just follow the rule. But so we'll trust a relationship. Hear what I just said. So many of us, you know, think that God says, hey, do everything I commanded. Meditate on what I've said, know all about me, follow my rules, and you'll be successful in everything you do. No. God's not saying, hey, just follow the rule book. God's saying, meditate on this kind of stuff. Know who I am. Know what I said. Know what I said about me. Know what I said about you. Because I want you to meditate on that. I want you to think of those things. I want you to renew your mind with those things. Because you know what? I want you in a right relationship with your Creator. And so many of us are trying to follow the rule instead of walk into the fullness of a relationship with the one who created us to live life. God has invited you, no matter who you are, into a relationship. But you got to know what He has said. What He has said. Do you know what He has said? First of all, know this. God is for you, not against you. The Word of God is written for us to understand who God is and understand who we are and live in a right relationship with our Creator. You got to understand the reason He has given this book, His Word, the reason He came in flesh from heaven to earth is so that we can know who He is and know who we are and live in a right relationship with Him. It's not to follow some rule. God has given commandments. He has given the characteristic of who He is to show us that we've stepped outside of that, but He's invited us back into that, and He wants you and I in a relationship. You've got to know He's for you, not against you. God's Word is not against you, it's for you. God sees more in you, my friend, than you see in yourself. God sees more in your kids than you see in your kids. God has designed us for a great purpose. But so many of us, you know, we don't know that God is for us and we think He's against us. We think He's some kind of big bad wolf with a hairy beard up in heaven watching for us to mess up. My friend, no, He's watching for you because He greatly loves you and He greatly wants you in a right relationship with Him and He greatly wants you to reflect His image into the world around you. Bible says, we were reminded of this last night, the millennial tour, in case you weren't here. God is love. God is love. That's what the scriptures say about our great God. And He loves you. He loves you so much that he gave his one and only son so you could know the magnitude of his love. You've got to understand that you are significant and God is not against you. You've got to also know this. That a lot of the times these battles in our life and these things that we're facing are kind of like the physical battles Joshua and the Israelites faced as they journeyed into the promised land, into the land of Canaan. And God wants to drive out the enemies of our soul. And you have enemies of your soul. We all battle with enemies. But you got to know that God wants to drive out these enemies of your soul that plague you from experiencing the fullness of his promise. And so many times we don't, you know, as God drove out these physical enemies, so the people could find rest in the land, we don't get this. And there's a lot of physical enemies that we have that go on in our mind. There's a lot of spiritual enemies that we have. But my friend, God wants to drive those enemies out. Those enemies out. And I know they get in your mind and they jack you up just like they jack me up. But God says, drive them out. Drive them out. Walk in the fullness of what I said. Walk in the fullness of what I've done. Walk in the fullness of what I'm going to do. And no matter what circumstance happens to you, you got to understand that the Bible says we, those of us who have believed in Jesus and we're followers of Jesus and God is our salvation and Jesus is our salvation, that, you know what, we win. I'm just encouraged. I can screw up today right here on this stage. I can fall off, but I win. I'm encouraged. And so, no matter, it's not that I strive to mess up, but I do mess up. But I understand who I win, and every time those things get in me and begin to hold me back from my God potential, I'm like, hey, God, I need you to drive this enemy out of Canaan because I win. And I want you to understand today, God don't want to just drive one enemy out and then you settle. God wants to continue to drive them all out so that you experience the fullness of his promise and you begin to be his people, not in the land of Canaan, but today in this land and express who he is to everybody else around you. God has a purpose for his church. And it's for us to shine. Not for us to be downtrodden, not for us to be kind of, you know, continually always like, oh, woe is me, poor is me. You know, I got pulled over for drunk driving last night on the way home from the concert. It's being honest. But I wasn't drunk. I'm being serious. And the officer said, he pulled me over and says, hey, you made a wrong turn. You swerved into oncoming traffic and you crossed three lanes and you did this and that and the other. And I said, hey, have you ever heard of Acts chapter 2? No, I didn't say that. Most of you don't get that. But they accused the people of being drunk in Acts chapter 2 and they were full of God's spirit. No. I was just kind of tired and not paying attention. And somebody, you know, I was trying to maneuver through what we call, I don't know the real proper word for this, but vacation traffic. I was trying to maneuver around some of those people who don't know how to drive on 17. They're kind of looking for everything else. Come on, somebody. But I didn't get all into that. And he says, hey, I pulled you over for, can you get out of your vehicle and step back here? He says, you smell like alcohol. Do what you got to do. Bro, I promise. You know, I might have wanted to take a drink a couple of times, but tonight I ain't been drinking. I've been like hanging out with people. I'm trying to go home and go to bed. I got to preach in the morning. He says, where you been? I said, to church. He said, at 11:30 at night. No. I know he thought I was lying. He finally let me go. I said, do what you got to do, man. You want me to walk your crooked line or what? I mean, I was really nice. What? I don't know why I told you that story. Did it have anything to do with the message? Huh? Yeah, it did. You know, obviously we got a purpose. We got to shine. I didn't argue with the officer. I just said, yes, sir. No, sir. Do what you got to do. You know what? It was normal. You know, he was doing his job, and I did swerve across the line, and he was so generous. He didn't even give me a ticket for that. So bless his heart. You know, it was incredible. Sweet spot of God's success. Let's get back on task. Some ADD just really kicked in. Know what God has said. Know what God has said. Somebody else can tell you who you are, but if you reflect on what God has said about you and begin to understand who he says you are, you can walk in the fullness of that and you can have peace. My point here is when the guy pulled me over last night, I knew I hadn't been drinking. I knew who I was. I knew what I was doing. I knew, you know, exactly where I was. I was not guilty of what he was saying. And I was walking in the fullness. Do what you got to do, bro. Can I tell you something? The thing is with our Christian life. When you know who God has said you are, and when you know he says you are a masterpiece, when you know he says he is for you, not against you, when you know he says you are to be a light into this world, when you know he says he wants to provide for exactly what he has designed you to do, when you begin to walk in the fullness of what God has said, and he has said, you are fully forgiven because of what I sacrificed on a cross, you are being birthed anew because my resurrection defeated sin, death, and the grave. My friend, when you walk in that, you're not looking back, you're looking forward. Know who God is, know who you are. Sweet spot of God's success. Number two, it's all about trust. It's all about a relationship. Do you trust your Creator? Do you trust what he said? Do you trust who you are in Christ? Second thing we learn about this relationship and walking in the fullness of God's promise is this. We begin to walk in the fullness of God's promise when we put our Creator first, when we put God first. It's very interesting that the first city that Joshua and the Israelite people conquered in this land flowing with milk and honey, the first battle they faced was a place called Jericho. And it's interesting what God told Joshua to do whenever they took Jericho down. He didn't say, hey, rise up your swords and roll up in there and be all that in a bag of chips. He says, depend on me. He says, I need you to march around Jericho. You know what, you people, the walls of Jericho, they were high, fortified. He says, I need you to march around them and don't say a word for 6 days. And then on the seventh day, I need you to do something even crazier. I need you to march around them seven times. By the way, the number seven. On the seventh day, God, you don't know? On the seventh day, God rested. He says, on the seventh day, I want you to march around it seven times and blow your trumpet and watch what happens. So if you rest and you trust in who I am, God's saying, and not depend upon yourself, kind of breaking all that down, and begin to understand that I am going before you, and I'm fighting in front of you, and I need you to trust me, put me first in everything you do, then I will continue to move you forward in the promises, in the fullness of who I say I am. There is a problem in our society today, in our church today, in the global church today. A lot of times we put me first and not God first. And though God dearly loves you and God dearly loves me, my friend, we have to understand that we put him first. We worship him. And we allow him to go before us, and he allows us to experience the fullness of the relationship. That's why we tithe here. It's the first tenth of the 100 God gives you. Do you trust God? Do you put Him first? Do you truly believe in His provision? Because I can tell you right now, that's what giving and tithing is all about. It's about the provision of God. And you have an opportunity every single week, every single month, every single year, every single gift card, every single paycheck to say, God, I put you first and I trust you for the fullness of your promises. That's what the giving moment we're going to do at the end of the service is all about. It's a trust moment. And again, I ask you to grapple with that. Who provides for you? Do you trust God first? Because honestly, that's a moment of worship, and that's what that moment's all about. It's about trust. Always put God first. Listen to what the Bible says in Joshua chapter 6. When the people heard the sound of the ram's horn, the Bible says they shouted just like God said, and as loud as they could, and suddenly the walls of Jericho collapsed as the Israelites charged straight into the town and they captured it. The Bible says there in 6:24, the Israelites burned the town just like God had said, everything in it, and only the things made of silver, gold, bronze, and iron were kept for the treasury of the Lord's house. Because God says, destroy, drive it completely out, destroy everything, and just keep this gold, this silver, this bronze for my treasury, because I want to keep advancing forward. That's what God told him. And I find it interesting, the first city they attacked is, God says, I'm going to go before you. I'm going to tear the walls down. You don't need to keep anything for yourself. You need to put me first. Put me first. In Joshua chapter 7, verse 1, the Bible says, but, everybody say, but. Not just one person, not just Achan, we're going to read about him in a minute, not just Achan who caused an aching for all of Israel, okay? Listen to what it says. But Israel violated the instruction about the things set apart for the Lord. A man named Achan had stolen some of the dedicated things, so the Lord was very angry with the Israelites. And so what happens if you study the scripture and you read it, they lose the next battle. See, I'm a firm believer, when we don't put God first, sometimes we win, sometimes we lose. But the reason we lose battles in our heart and in our life a lot of times is because we don't have things in proper order. Putting God first. My friend, I'm not just talking about in your money. I'm talking about in your marriage. I'm talking about in your relationships. I'm talking about at your job. I'm talking about in your home. I'm talking about in all areas of your life. Do you trust God? Because really, that's what putting Him first is all about. It means my life revolves around first. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. This is what the New Testament says in Matthew 6, verse 33. And that word first in that particular passage, it's a word that means to revolve around. Not just first in rank and first in order, but everything should revolve around this first that's used there in that text. Your life needs to revolve and trust who God is. Seek first His kingdom. The Bible says one of them didn't do it, and then they lost the battle, and you know it was bad. And so Joshua, he called a meeting, and the Bible says he began to ask people who did this, and Achan replied, it is true, I've sinned, I've missed the mark against what the Lord has said, the God of Israel. Among the plunder, he says, I saw. Everybody say, saw. Temptation will always come in a form of something that looks amazing to benefit you. I saw. You remember in the first sin of humanity, Adam and Eve, the lady did what? She looked and she saw the fruit, and it looked, the Bible says, it looked delicious. It looked delicious. Always looks delicious. Always looks delicious, but it can be devastating. The Bible says, the guy says, I saw a beautiful robe from Babylon, 200 silver coins and a bar of gold weighing more than a pound. He says, I wanted them so much that I took them. He says, I took them. They are hidden in the ground beneath my tent with the silver, and they're buried deeper than the rest. The Bible says that they straighten out this particular thing that had happened, and this group not putting God first. And though they were defeated in the battle right before that, the Bible says now, you know what, they begin to move forward and they win the battle. You say, what has all that got to do with me today? I'm just telling you right now, the lesson you need to learn is God needs to come first in all that you do. Because you're going to face battle after battle, AI, whoever else it is, whatever else, and you know, and the thing is a lot of times we lose battles in the promised land, in the promises of God, because we simply haven't put him first. Put him first. Understand that he is there for you. He is not against you. But see, first means I trust God. And if I could encourage anybody, if I were Joshua today, you know, and I was standing over here talking to you, the army of God and the people of God that he wanted to walk in the fullness of the promise, you and your family and your neighbors and your community, I would stand here and say, hey, put God first. First, 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 first. This is plaguing the church, the people of God. This is holding back what God wants to do through the local church. I'm not talking about this congregation. I'm talking about around the world. If God's people began to stick him first in the relationship, I'm telling you, every tribe, every tongue, and every nation will begin to understand who provides for us. And they're going to want an attachment to our Creator and our great God. Jesus said, seek first his kingdom, not my kingdom, not your kingdom, not your neighbor's kingdom, his kingdom and his righteousness. And he will add all of those things unto you as well. Seek first. If you are aching, then the question is, are you being an Achan? I've seen Achans here. The bucket passes through. And somebody drops an envelope in. Did you know that our people who count the money sometimes open up empty envelopes? The envelope ain't for you to show everybody else that you are participating. The envelope is there for you to stick money in and seek God first. And listen, it don't matter who sees you, and it don't matter what rule you followed. The question is, does your heart really believe that God is the provider and you are worshiping him as a provider? Are you a cheerful giver is what the Bible says, not a reluctant giver? Are you giving because you believe God has given unto you? Seek first. Seek first. Seek first. Trust what God has said. Seek him first. You want to walk in the fullness of the promise? You want to live in the sweet spot of God's success for your life? You want it for our church? Seek first. Seek first. Joshua, lead my people into the fullness of the promise. Take them into the land of Canaan. There's going to be battles, but I need you to roll. So they sought God first, finally. They got that straightened out. And the next thing I wrote down is this, is leverage your stuff, but worship God. Leverage your stuff, but worship God. The battle that all of us face, even me as a pastor, is a lot of times when God blesses you with provision, a lot of times it's easier to worship what has been created instead of the Creator itself. Don't miss this. And so it's interesting what happens next. They take out Jericho. They straighten out, putting God first. And the very next thing, the very next city, the very next battle they were to take for the provision of God in Joshua 8, chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, it says this. Then the Lord said to Joshua, this time, do not be afraid or discouraged. Take your fighting men, and I need you to attack Ai, the place that just defeated you. Now you're going to defeat it. For I have given you the king of Ai, his people, his town, and his land. You will destroy them as you have destroyed Jericho and its kings. But this time, you may keep the plunder and the livestock for yourselves. Put me first, then I'm going to take care of you. Seek first. Seek first, and you know what? Now you can keep it. But the interesting thing is what he continues to say here in Joshua 8 is significant. Because I do believe that God wants to prosper his people. I do believe that God wants us to live above normal. I do believe that God wants us to know who he is and be in right relationship with him. But he never wants the created to take over the creator. And it's so easy. It happened to the Israelites over and over again. It's why they continually went in captivity and into bondage. And it happens in the local church today. And it's easier to worship this service and your family sitting around you and the people around you than to recognize God has given you all of this to know who he is and to make him known into the universe. Congregations all over the world are about us four and no more. That's how I say it. That means, you know what, this is good enough. We've been blessed. No. Use the blessing to accomplish God's mission and his message. A lot of people say, why y'all have these lights and all this stuff and the screens? Do you really need that to get the message out? In this culture, my answer would be, it's one of the best vehicles in the world to get the message out. Use your stuff. Use what you have in order to share who God is. Don't worship the stuff. Don't hoard the stuff. Why do you do that? And it's interesting what he says a little bit later in that passage. I find this fascinating. He didn't only say this to Joshua. He said it to Moses too as Moses was leading the people. In Joshua 8 verses 30 through 31, the Bible says once this all kind of went down and the Bible says, then Joshua built an altar to the Lord, the God of Israel, on Mount Ebal. He followed the commands that Moses, the Lord's servant, had written in the book of the instruction. Make me an altar from stones that are uncut and have not been shaped with iron tools. This is significant because God is saying, listen, I want you to use stones that I created, the creator created. And you know what? It ain't about your work. It's about my work. Uncut. They're not chiseled out because I need you to know that I'm the one providing, you know what, the altar. I'm the one providing the work. And the greatest altar that we ever see throughout Scripture, all of the blood sacrifices on the altar that were uncut by human hands that were there for God, for the blood to be spilled on those altars. The Bible says, you know what, the cross of Christ is like an altar where God says, I'm doing the work. It's not about what you have, but use what you have, but don't begin to think that you are doing the work. That don't mean anything to some of you. But what a lot of us are trying to do is we're trying to work. Work, 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 work. I gotta do more for God so God's more pleased with me. I gotta show up. I gotta show him how cut I am, how awesome I am, how amazing I am. So he'll be more pleased with me. No. The work for humanity was done on a cross. What God so gave the world on a cross, shed his blood on a cross to forgive you and me for our sin. He says that was enough for all of humanity. Will you trust the uncut cross where Christ was slaughtered and beat to death for you to be in a relationship with the God of the universe? My friend, it ain't about your work. It's about Christ's work. And a lot of times we're trying to use what we have to show God how awesome we are. My friend, he already sees you through a different lens than you see yourself. He sees you through the lens of his Son, Jesus Christ. He sees you as perfect, and he sees you as whole if you have trusted the provision that God has made on a cross. And the reason you are so anxious maybe about life and what's next is because you have started trusting created things instead of the Creator himself. Wow. It's so easy for us to trust the created over the Creator. Where I would encourage you to trust the Creator first, and as he blesses you, begin to be a blessing. This outfit don't make me cool. I know you think it's cool. But I'm cool because of who God said I am. My preaching and my spitting and my hollering don't make me anything. But it's the gift God uses to do everything. And so I submit myself to who God says I am. I walk in the fullness, and I use my outfit, I use my gift, I use my stage, I use whatever I've got to do to let people know that I have trusted one who gave his life on a cross, resurrected from a grave, and they can too. Put God first. Put God first, and then worship God, not the stuff that God provides for you. Leverage it. And then the last thing I wrote down is this: stay faithful. Amen. Stay faithful. I'm telling you, you're going to face some battles in the promises of God. But Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. The war for your soul has been finished because of what Christ has done. But daily you will battle for rest in his provision because of what you face. You can conquer the battles if you trust God first, believe his word, begin to be about his message and his mission, and then stay faithful on the journey. You can't, my friend, you can't lose what God has provided for you. And if he has provided salvation for you through Christ Jesus, let me make it clear. You didn't earn it. You received it by faith. It wasn't what you did or didn't do. It's what you believed with your heart. However, on the journey, in this life eternal, the Bible says it is impossible to please God without faith. Stay faithful. Listen to what Joshua says at the end of his life. My friends, I'm telling you, if there is one man, one human in Scripture outside of Christ that walked in the fullness of who God said he was, it was this man named Joshua. From Joshua 1, when he took over leadership, until Joshua 23, 24, where he left this world, he remained faithful. He believed God over the people. He believed God over the enemy. He believed God over the adversity. He believed God over the blessings. He believed God over everything. He believed he was created by God, for God, and to do something great with his life. He believed that he was created to be in a relationship with God. So he lived in the sweet spot of God's success. It doesn't mean that he didn't face battles. I know you're going to face battles. I'm going to face them too. I face them daily. How about you? But how do you get back up and continue to move forward and walk in the fullness of God's promise? Rest in God. Rest in Christ. See, a lot of us don't know what that means a lot of times. Resting in Christ doesn't mean that you don't have battles in this world. Resting in Christ is to know who God is and to know who you are. And despite what you face or battle you face, you know that God is going to see you through it. Listen to what Joshua says. He says, so I need you to respect the Lord in Joshua 24, verse 14. So I need you to fear, this is at the end of his life, I need you to fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshiped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. Serve the Lord alone. Serve the Creator alone. Serve God alone is what Joshua was telling the people. And people were serving all kinds of things. And, you know, and they were like, probably like, you know, it's just a little statue. Joshua, we do love God. Just shatter that thing, man. Get rid of it. Serve God alone. Serve God, the Bible says he is a jealous God. He loves you so much that he's like a jealous husband over his wife. And what that means is he loves you so dearly. If something tries to pull you away from that love, he is so much in pursuit of you, he'll begin to take those things out. And if for a minute you begin to give your allegiance to something else, he'll do whatever it is in your life, in that thing's life, to turn your heart back towards him, the great husband. There's a whole book in the Bible that talks about it. That no matter how far you have gone and where you have been, no matter how many times you have prostituted on your Creator, the Bible says that, you know what? He hunts you down. He hunts you down and he'll begin to speak in your heart. And maybe that's what he's doing right now. The Bible says in Hebrews 11 verse 6 that, you know what? It's impossible to please God without faith. It's impossible to please God without faith. Listen to what it says. Hebrews 11 verse 6. It's impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who sincerely seek him. The question is, what is your faith in? Is it in the God of the universe who came to hunt you down from heaven? That's why Jesus came and shed his blood on the cross. It's why Jesus resurrected from a grave. It's why God recorded this in Scripture. The story of Joshua. And so we'll remain faithful to the end. And a lot of times we don't receive the promises of God because we're not remaining faithful to the end. My friend, you may have crossed over, but are you continually trusting God? And maybe you're not winning some of the battles in life because you're not standing in the sweet spot like Joshua did and always putting God first, always believing God over what everybody else is saying, always believing God had more for you, always believing in God's provision, always continuing to pursue him, telling everybody else, listen, if you got eyes for anything else, you need to shatter those idols because there is one God who greatly and dearly loves you as a person. He gave his life on a cross, and there's nothing that can take his place, and he'll pursue you with all of his heart. The question is, will you turn your heart to this great love, to this one that loves you so much that he gave his one and only son? My friends, this is good news, that God loves you. He's faithful. He's even faithful when we are faithless. He'll hunt you down, and maybe that's what he's doing in your seat today. See, I think some of us may have never truly trusted God. I mean, truly trusting our Creator to be in a relationship with him. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. My friends, 18 years ago, I'd heard all about Jesus. I'd walked the journey. Sometimes, you know, doing the Sunday school thing, doing the religious thing. I pursued a lot of other things in life. I pursued a lot of other lovers, stuff, relationships. I thought that was what was going to make me whole. I pursued this, that, and the other. And it was for me surrendering and saying, God, I want to live in the sweet spot of your success. I didn't understand all this stuff. I just understood that, you know what? Nothing I was pursuing was bringing me rest for my soul. However, the moment I truly began to comprehend the good news that in spite of my faithlessness, me not being faithful, that God was still faithful and he loved me in spite of who I was. The moment I surrendered in that spot is the moment I began to say 18 years ago, God, I want what you have for my life. I don't want what I have for my life. That's true surrender. My wife, Kim, and myself, we got on our living room floor. And we're like, God, you've given us a lot. We've experienced a lot. But whatever it is you have for us, God, we want to walk in the fullness of that. I literally told God this. You're going to think I'm crazy. But I was a landscaper, and I owned a retail garden center for many, many years. And I told God, I said, God, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. I want to be yours. I want to be used by you. Listen, I don't care what she thinks about me. I don't care about what they think about me. I don't care what the bank account says about me. I don't care about all of these other things. God, I just want to be who you created me to be. And 18 years ago, we got on our knees and I said, God, if that means, and if you don't know what a crepe myrtle is, it's just a bush, a tree. I said, God, if it's to be on my knees below a crepe myrtle for the next 40 years, I want to be in that spot. I wasn't saying, God, if you want me on a stage, I want to be in that spot. God, if you want me to do this, I want to be in that spot. It was like, God, wherever you want me, if it's across the world, I want to be in that spot. And honestly, ever since then, I didn't fully understand it, but I began to walk in the fullness of God's promises. And every single time I get off track, God continues to bring me back and says, no, this is the spot. This is the spot. And this is the spot. And though I have battles and I want to quit and I want to do this and this is the spot. This is the spot. This is your assignment. Walk in the fullness. And I lay my head down at night when I walk in the fullness of who he says I am. And I rest, and I rest well. I got challenges. Bunches of them. But I lay my head down at night and I rest. And the reason I rest is because I'm doing what God has created me to do. I invite you into that today. Trust. Seek first. Put him before everything else. Leverage what you have and remain faithful. Even when you are faithless, God is faithful, and you can turn your heart back towards Him this very day. Can you bow your heads? God, thank you so much for what you're doing in and through our church. God, you're amazing, and there's some people here today who need to trust you for the first time truly with their heart. God, they need to put their faith in the one that you gave on a cross, as the Bible refers to as Jesus, the firstborn in this new order. God, he gave his life, he surrendered his life, and he resurrected. And your word says if we trust what you offered, that God, we become your children in Christ. And you're creating us anew into this amazing masterpiece so we can do what you created for us to do before the foundations of the world. God, if there's a person here today that's trusting their work, trusting what they do, trusting their religious act, trusting what they don't do, and God, they're trusting everything around them, I pray today, first and foremost, they would trust Christ. Put their faith in the one who came from heaven, gave his life on a cross, and resurrected from the grave 3 days later. And God, their new journey begins. And God, also, before we move into the closing moments, I want to pray that those of us who have trusted Christ, but God, we don't walk in the sweet spot of your success and the fullness of who you say we are. God, there's a lot that plagues our minds and our hearts today. I pray you would shatter those things and let us focus on you and what you have for our life. Not what we wear, not what we see, not what they say, but God, what you have said. You're an amazing, amazing God. I pray this prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you give the Lord a hand clap today?